Once upon a time, there was a great wind, a mighty life-giving energy that breathed everything into existence, a power that moved along the waters of the deep, the Spirit of God. One day, a group who loved God was praying and meeting, celebrating a Jewish feast with friends and family, unaware of what was going to happen. Heaven was about to pay a visit. A violent wind filled the room where they prayed. Tongues of fire descended, separated, and rested on each of them. The Spirit of God didn't just come near them, the Spirit filled them. And each one began to speak in a foreign language, the many languages of all the people who lived in Jerusalem. All those who passed by marveled at what they saw. How could it be that each one could hear their own native language at the same time? Some claimed it was miraculous. Others scoffed and called them drunk. But Peter stepped forward and boldly proclaimed the truth. What the scripture described long ago had now come to pass right before their eyes. "I will pour out my spirit," the Lord told his people. "Your sons and daughters will prophesy. Your young men will see visions. Your old men will dream dreams." Here was the moment. The power of God filled the faithful. The body of Christ rose up, alive and active, equipped and empowered to love God, to love others. The good news continues to be proclaimed. Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. And the best news is, for those who believe, the story never ends.
Amen. Happy Pentecost, everybody. Welcome. It's great to see everyone looking out, seeing a good amount of red, a good amount of traditional clothing. And I'm representing a little bit. I got some Scottish heritage. This is the Macintosh tartan. But thank you guys for joining us today. And we're really celebrating. I'm not doing as much as this guy right here. I really appreciate.
Go ahead.
Let's give a round of applause for the
kilt. Get it out.
He wore a kilt today.
Yeah, we're supposed to dress up for today, right?
That's right.
This is the Macintosh tartan.
I guess I forgot mine.
Yeah.
I'm really sorry.
Next year, right?
But yeah, we really are just really celebrating how God poured out his spirit on that day in Acts chapter 2 and really launched a multicultural, multi-ethnic body of believers. And we're really celebrating the Holy Spirit and his work, and we're celebrating the diversity. You know, it really is amazing when you look around this room and you see the diversity that God has provided us with. It really is an amazing thing, and I was just thinking about all the issues in the world that exist because people take something so good, which is diversity, and make it divide us and cause hostility and cause division. But it's so incredible to know that through Jesus, through the Holy Spirit, he puts all of that aside, and it's something beautiful, and we're really going to celebrate that today. And what we're going to do in our service is we're going to go through the narrative, this story, as I talked about in the video, a story that is still going. But we're going to really try to, with different elements and singing and worship and all the other elements, to really experience the narrative together as we celebrate. And so in just a moment, we're going to pray for our service, but I know Sherwin wanted to bring some things to our attention.
We have some special prayer requests. Kevin Broyles, we know Dr. Kevin Broyles, he's been keeping us up through the COVID time. His mother is having open heart surgery tomorrow, so if we can be praying for her. And also Lori Allen's mother had a stroke. So please be praying for her. Lori is going to connect with her. She's expressed already to Lori that she wants to get her life right with God and to make sure that is right. So please be praying that she can connect on that. Let's pray together. God, it is awesome to be together in your kingdom and just to know that literally around the world, and hours in the past and hours in the future, that we are all celebrating you. We are all worshiping you, people from every country, people from every tribe, from every group around the world, God, are expressing our love to you. It's amazing the diversity that you've given us just in the tongues that we speak, in the costumes that we have, the traditional wear, the customs that we have, but we are all united in your family. Thank you for that. Help us to celebrate our diversity. Help us to grow more in understanding one another and being able to listen to one another in respecting the culture, the customs of each other, and being able to incorporate those into our friendships, into our worship here, and into our relationship with you. Thank you so much for today when we get to celebrate Pentecost and to know a real day, a real celebration that happened centuries ago. God, I do pray that you will remember these prayer requests that we've already mentioned for Kevin Broyles' mom, for Rita, with open heart surgery. Pray that everything will go well, be with all the doctors, the nurses, the anesthesiologists to be able to minister to her. And also, God, we do pray for Lori Allen's mother, for Winifred Sams, for her stroke, to be able to completely recover from that, and help Lori to be able to connect her mom with her mom, and just for her really to be solid and in her faith and her relationship with you. God, bless us as we go on. Thank you so much for your grace. Thank you so much for Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I'll be reading from Acts 1, verses 1 through 11, and Acts chapter 2, verses 1 through 4. In my former book, Theophilus, I wrote about all that Jesus began to do and to teach until the day that he was taken up to heaven after giving instructions through the Holy Spirit to the apostles he had chosen. After his suffering, he presented himself to them and gave many convincing proofs that he was alive. He appeared to them over a period of 40 days and spoke about the kingdom of God. On one occasion, he was eating with them. He gave them this commandment: do not leave Jerusalem, but wait for the gift my father promised, which you have heard me speak about. For John baptized with water, but in a few days you will be baptized with the Holy Spirit. Then they gathered around him and asked him, Lord, are you at this time going to restore the kingdom of Jerusalem, of Israel? He said to them, it is not for you to know the times or dates the Father has set by his own authority, but you will receive power when the Holy Spirit comes on you, and you will be my witnesses in Jerusalem and in all Judea and Samaria and to the ends of the earth. After he said this, he was taken up before their very eyes, and a cloud hid him from their sight. They were looking intently up into the sky as he was going, when suddenly two men dressed in white stood beside them. Men of Galilee, they said, why do you stand here looking into the sky? This same Jesus who has been taken from you into heaven will come back in the same way you have seen him go into heaven. Acts 2. When the day of Pentecost came, they were all together in one place. Suddenly, a sound like the blowing of a violent wind came from heaven and filled the whole house where they were sitting. They saw what seemed to be tongues of fire that separated and came to rest on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit.
Power.
Sing that with us.
Spirit of the living God, fall fresh on me. Spirit of the living God,
I would rather be, no place I would rather be, no place I would rather be, here in your love, here in your love, no place I would rather be, no place I would rather be, no place I would rather be, here in your love, here in your love.
Sweet, sweet, sweet. must experience the glory of your goodness. Let us become
Thank you. God, we thank you for your presence. We thank you that you love us enough to dwell with us, to dwell in us and amongst us. Thank you for pouring out your spirit as you did on that day. Help us to be aware. Help us to be reliant on your spirit at every step. Help us not take one step without you. How could we live without you, really? To truly live in the image you created us to be. We humble ourselves, we need you, and we thank you and we celebrate you in your name.
Acts 2, verse 4. And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them utterance. Now there were dwelling in Jerusalem Jews, devout men from every nation under heaven. And as this sound, the multitude came together, and they were bewildered, because each one was hearing them speak in his own language. And they were amazed and astonished, saying, "Are not all these who are speaking Galileans? And how is it that we hear, each of us in our own native languages, Parthians and Medes, Elamites and residents of Mesopotamia, Judea, Cappadocia, Pontus and Asia, Phrygia and Pamphylia, Egypt and the parts of Libya belonging to Cyrene, and visitors from Rome, both Jews and proselytes, Cretans and Arabians, we hear them telling in our own tongues the mighty works of God."
El Señor es clemente y compasivo, lento para la ira y grande en amor. El Señor es bueno con todos, Él se compadece de toda su creación. Que te hablen, Señor, todas tus obras, que te bendigan tus fieles, que hablen de la gloria de tu reino, que proclamen tus proezas, para que todo el mundo conozca tus proezas y la gloria y el esplendor de tu reino. Tu reino es un reino eterno, tu dominio permanece por todas las edades.
腓立比书4:4-7.
Великие и чудные Твои дела, Господь, Бог, Вседержитель. Твои пути справедливы и истинны, Царь народов. Кто не устражится Тебя, Господи, и не прославит Твоего имени? Ведь Ты один только свят. К Тебе придут на поклонение все народы, потому что все узнали о Твоих справедливых судах.
L'Éternel est mon berger, je ne manquerai de rien. Il me fait reposer dans des verts pâturages. Il me dirige près des eaux paisibles et il restaure mon âme.
Padre nuestro que estás en el cielo, santificado sea tu nombre.
que ta règne vienne sur la terre et comme au ciel.
Дай нам сегодня наш насущный хлеб. Прости нам наши долги, как и мы простили должникам нашим.
不叫我们遇见试探，救我们脱离凶恶。
Porque
el Señor es el reino, el
Señor es la
Amén.
Amén.
I'm just speaking in English, so y'all will be all right. Amen. Wasn't that cool to hear all those languages at the same time? Yeah. I just got to give a shout out. The woman that was speaking in Chinese, she's actually a friend of mine from Mercer. We go to school together. And when I was putting this together, I was like, man, I know Ting. I mean, she's amazing. And she was baptized in her church out in China like a little over a year ago or something like that. And she just felt called and wanted to go to seminary and came to the United States of America, didn't really know anybody. And she had to get quarantined, you know how the crazy COVID, all that stuff. And I think she came out of quarantine and 2 days later was her first class. And so even though English is not her first language, obviously, she blows me away at how she's able to retain everything. And so hopefully y'all can meet her, you know, and be nice to her and all that good stuff. So, amen. Hopefully the Holy Spirit is within you and you can be, you know, loving. You know, hey, happy Pentecost, man. This is a day to celebrate, right? You know, to celebrate the Holy Spirit. And that's really what I was, you know, in the time that I have, I'm actually going to share my message with Tony Karamidas. So he's going to do a little bit, a part of the message, but a little bit later. But when I was thinking, like, what do I want to talk about when it comes to the Holy Spirit? And honestly, I just felt like, man, you know, the Spirit's presence is what I wanted to celebrate, to be totally honest with you. And it'd probably be good to have my clicker, right? That would be good. There you go. The Holy Spirit can't help you if you don't do certain things, so there you go. And I know that's kind of simplistic, but, you know, I just feel like that's what we need to celebrate, the presence of God's Spirit. And then I thought, you know, I'm grateful that the Holy Spirit is not insecure or resentful, because the Holy Spirit does not get enough airtime. You know what I mean? I mean, God the Father, amen, you know, Jesus, oh my gosh, Jesus, you know, we got Christmas, we got Easter, but what about the Spirit? Oh, thanks for coming out, Holy Spirit. You know, that's how sometimes we are. And I was like, no, we need to remember and respect the Holy Spirit. You know, honestly, that's kind of where I'm coming from. Like, I want us to have the heart to, like, let's not forget the Holy Spirit. And here's the reality. You know, Jesus said something ridiculously crazy when he was alive. And he said something to his disciples that I'm sure they didn't totally understand. And even to this day, I'm not sure if we fully, fully understand. See if you remember this moment. And if you were one of his disciples, would you have totally believed this or even understood it? Jesus once told his disciples, "But I tell you the truth, it is to your advantage that I am going away. For if I do not go away, the advocate," and he's talking about the Spirit there, "will not come to you. But if I go, I will send him to you. And when he comes, he will prove the world wrong concerning sin and righteousness and judgment." Jesus was saying it is to the advantage of the disciples. And I'm sure they didn't get it. You know why I'm sure they didn't get it? Because read the Gospels. Almost everything Jesus said, they didn't get. You know, we just had a series on apologetics. Let me just throw in a little teaser there for you, too. The fact that the disciples who wrote the Gospels were the two that were with Jesus and those that weren't but still got the information, look how bad they look in those Gospels. That's another reason to believe they're true. Who else would depict themselves as such dumb people? Do you know what I mean? Like, you wouldn't do that if you were trying to write a history, right? You would try to make yourself look good. But so many times the disciples didn't get it. They'd be getting teaching from Jesus all day long, still not get it. And then there'd be a blind dude on the side of the road who's old, can't see nothing. Oh, David, you know, the son of David, the Messiah. And you go, how does he get it? And they don't get it. That is, I think, what's happening here. I don't think they got it. Who is this advocate? And who? He's going to come. It's better for him to be here than you, Jesus? That's crazy. And I think we feel the same way today. And that's why we need days like Pentecost, where we celebrate what happens when God's Spirit intervenes into our lives. And that is exactly what happened. God's Spirit, when we open up our Bible, the first page we see the Holy Spirit. He's hovering over the waters. If there's no Holy Spirit, there's no sunset. There's no spring bloom of the flowers and things like that. There's no conception and embryo and child and all these crazy things that we go, what is going on? The Spirit is that essence of creation and so much. And we just refuse to see it sometimes. The Holy Spirit, when God said, I want to be among my people, and even gave them a way to create at least a place, the tabernacle, right? It was God's Spirit there. What about the temple? When he filled the temple with his Spirit, this place where God would meet with his people, a place where heaven and earth would meet. What about Jesus as a baby? What about the Spirit with Mary? And then we get Jesus. The Spirit was involved. And the Spirit, what about the resurrection? The Spirit, the power of God through the Holy Spirit, rose Jesus from the dead. Why do we relegate and forget about the Spirit? That's why we need Pentecost. We need to remember and we need to respect the power of God's Spirit. And on that day, when Peter, who couldn't figure nothing out to save his life, right? But all of a sudden, Peter has all this wisdom from God's Spirit. And he's telling people, what's going on? No, these people aren't drunk. It's only 9 a.m. They are preaching. They are explaining what God has been doing. And look at this part. This is a part that I appreciate as well. When Peter starts explaining, he says something that's very helpful. He says, this Jesus God raised up, and we are all witnesses of it. So then, exalted to the right hand of God, and having received the promise of the Holy Spirit from the Father, he has poured out what you both see and hear. This is really what Jesus was talking about. If I don't go to the Father, I won't be able to send you the Spirit. So Peter's explaining, this is Jesus. This is him pouring out the Spirit. This is the Spirit of Jesus. This is what is happening. And what happens when God's Spirit descends upon a people and envelops a people? And what happens? Amazing things can happen. And if you're visiting with us and you're, new and you're, oh, the Spirit, that sounds kind of, I don't know if I can put my finger on it. I'm just saying, listen and surrender and think about this. If you could just explain everything away, then why would we need God? There should be some elements where we can't just grab hold of it and go, I got it all figured out. And when the Spirit came on those people and Peter's explaining things, we're very familiar with this passage, but if you're visiting or if you're new and you're online and you're just checking things out, this is a very helpful passage. And Peter says, let all the house of Israel know beyond a doubt that God has made this Jesus whom you crucified both Lord and Christ. And when they heard this, they were acutely distressed and said to Peter and the rest of the apostles, what should we do, brothers? And Peter said to them, repent. Turn away from your life. Turn to God. Change the way you think. Let God take over your thinking. Turn to him. Repent. Each one of you be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ for the forgiveness of your sins, and you will receive the gift of the Holy Spirit. For this promise is for you and your children and for all who are far away, as many as the Lord our God will call to himself. And with many other words, he testified and exhorted them, saying, save yourselves from this perverse generation. So those who accepted his message were baptized, and about 3,000 people were added. 3,000 people responded. That's what happens when God's Spirit comes. People's hearts get changed. Right? Because the Spirit can help them understand the difference. What is sin? What is righteousness? What about judgment? You and I, we're not so great at figuring out what sin is, what sin isn't, who's judging, right? You and I aren't great at that. The Holy Spirit ain't got no problem with that. and he knows how to take care of it. And so when he came in that moment, people understood their sin. They understood what they needed to do, and they needed to turn away from their lives and turn to God and be baptized. And 3,000 people got baptized that day. Powerful, right? Powerful moment. And I came across this quote when I was preparing this, and I thought this was interesting, and I figured I'd share it with you. The Acts story says that 3,000 people were baptized on the day of Pentecost. We need to remember that those 3,000 included people known today as Iranians, Iraqis, Turks, Asians, Africans, and Europeans, the known world of the New Testament. The Feast of Pentecost challenges our hope and faith. Each week we proclaim, I believe in the Holy Spirit. Pentecost asks how deeply we mean that. Are we willing to let Christ's Spirit impassion and empower us? Are we willing to be led beyond our culturally comfortable worlds to form communities that includes such diversity and such different points of view? Wow, right? That's the beauty of when the Spirit comes among a people. It doesn't matter what kind of people you are. Iranian, Iraqi, Turks, Arabs, Russian, Ukrainian, right? God can bring them all together through the power of His Spirit. You and I, we're not able to do that in and of ourselves. Some of us are overly reliant upon Congress or stuff like that, or people that make laws as if they can legislate the type of unity that can only come through the Spirit of God. We are the answer to God saying, this is how the world should be. His church, when the Holy Spirit, it doesn't matter what you look like, doesn't matter where you come from. If God's Spirit has taken over, you can be united. And that is the beauty of the church, and that is the beauty of what we, and hey, here's the deal. So many times we offer something at this church. It's called New to North River. And it's for people that are just, you know, they're trying to ask questions and figure stuff out. I'm telling you, I've been, I don't know how many of them, in 15, 16 years I've been here. I can't remember a time when someone didn't say something along the lines of, man, I've never seen a church with this many different type of people in it. And hey, you and I know that we're members here, we know we got problems, right? Come on, let's be real. We don't agree on everything, but look around. You showed up this morning. And it's not because of any one person or this or that. I hope because you realize that God's Spirit is among us. And that is why we can have a group like this. And that's why some of you can sit and listen to a song that don't have the kind of vibe and the beat that you like from your culture. But you go, hey, man, they like it, right? And when you realize you're listening to a song that's a little funkier than maybe you like, you can go, well, at least they like it, amen, right? And we can be together. I wish we could laugh about some of the other things I could mention that we seem to struggle about. Do you understand what I'm saying? Okay. And so we gotta remember who we are. We are the answer to what is wrong in this world. Not because of how smart you individually are, but because of what God's Spirit can do among all of us. It's a we thing and not a me thing. It's not about I. It's not just I can have a personal relationship with God. Amen, that's great. That's a part of the deal, but that's not the whole deal. God's got a bigger plan, and it involves all of us. Amen? I am running out of my time. I'm going to tell you what. You know, I'm going to tell you what. I want to commend you because I do want to commend you, though, because while we might have some differences and we got to figure things out, and I pray that we allow the Spirit to indwell us in a powerful way and let the Spirit come out of us instead of our regurgitation of the latest talking head, hopefully we can do better at that. But I want to commend you on something that I see in the Scriptures, what happens when the Spirit comes among a people. They change the way they think about stuff, especially in this country, they stuff. Right? Your possessions. And I want to commend you because I feel like, I honestly believe we're growing even better and better every year. And how generous we can be. I read this quote when I was researching too. Just talking about the churches where there was not a needy person, right? Quoting Acts. since the sharing of ideals took on flesh. Think about that. We can have all these great ideals, but if it don't show up in the way you live, what's the point? The sharing of ideals took on flesh in the sharing of possessions whenever a need arose, especially in Western culture, where mine and more are among the first words our children learn. We need to work hard to inculcate, fancy word for instruct, the alternative Christian watchwords of ours or God's. And enough where possessions are concerned. It ain't about you. It ain't just your. It's God's. It's ours. It ain't just a me thing. It's a we thing. And I'm telling you, the more we got to really meditate on this and let it change our hearts and our minds and our lives. Because God is trying to fashion us. Because here's the deal. When Jesus left, his physical presence wasn't here in his bodily form, but he's still here through his church. That's why it's to this world's advantage. There's not just one Jesus in one physical place at one time. It's his church all around the world. It's all these different languages represented. Believe it. Believe in the Spirit. Believe what he can do. Surrender to him and let him take over this place. Amen. I'm going to say a word. I'm going to say a word of prayer for the Lord's Supper. Apologize for going a little long. Don't kill me. Love you. Let's pray. Father, we just want to surrender to you and express our gratitude for your Spirit, your sacred Spirit, your Holy Spirit, the Spirit that knows what sin is and what sin isn't, what is righteousness and what isn't righteous, and prepares us for when you are going to make everything right here on earth as it is in heaven. And we know that comes through Jesus and his Spirit. And we're grateful as we take the bread that represents Jesus' body. We remember him and his teachings and his life. And we remember what he endured in the life that he lived from the people around him who put him on a cross. But he was willing to stay on that cross. And you, in your power through the Spirit, rose him from the, he rose from the dead, Lord. And now we have the same hope. And as we drink this juice, we remember the blood he shed. But we proclaim that we believe, not just with our words, but with our lives. Thank you, Lord, for this plan, this foreknowledge that you had. And it looked like a defeat when Jesus hung on that cross, but that was not a defeat. It was a vindication as he rose from the dead. Help us to remember that, and help us to allow your Spirit to do what he wants to do in this church. Pray in his name. Amen.
Amen. We'll change things up. Wow, I feel like we could end it right after that. Jeez, that was beautiful. Absolutely beautiful. I've been asked to share about my conversion story before we sing a little African song that you might know. That's why I'm wearing this crazy shirt that doesn't fit me. But I really appreciate being asked to share because I'm not going to share my story. I feel like this is God's story. You know, we often think as we become Christians that this is my story, right? People ask you, what's your story? And yes, you were involved, but really it was God's story. And hopefully by the end of me speaking, you'll see that. Let me tell you who I am. Not who I was, who I am. I am arrogant. If you've known me for any length of time and you're still my friend, I appreciate that. But I am arrogant by nature, right? That's my natural bent. I think I know it all. I was arrogant when I first came to know Jesus, before I knew Jesus, and I grew up believing that I was better than other people. I know a lot of you can't relate to that, but I did. I just grew up believing that. My mom always told me I was great, that people loved me. I had enough negative influences, but somehow the positive ones are the messages I chose to hear, right? For better or worse. So I grew up always believing I was better. I did competitive sport, and I felt like, you know, I looked down on other people that weren't physically fit or didn't, you know, strive for something or weren't champions. That's what I wanted, to be a champion. And I became a champion at different points. And so I felt like I'm definitely better than those people, right? I'm very insecure. That's the second thing you should know about me. I'm naturally insecure. I grew up in a tough home environment with physical abuse. And I definitely got the message from my parents, as much as they loved me, that they loved me a little more when I was a champion. And so when I was putting my best face forward, I felt like that's when I was the most loved, right? So I grew up insecure and like I had to earn people's love. I was also what I call fatally independent. Independence is praised, right? You're given glory for being independent and strong. But there's a different kind of independence that can kill you. And I feel like I'm fatally independent. I was beaten as a kid by my stepfather. You know, I realized kind of early on that I couldn't tell anybody about that. So I developed this, I'm going to have to do it myself mentality, right? No one's going to be there for me. Even if they want to be, they can't be. So I'm not going to need people. And that developed this fatal independence in me. And my phone's on low power mode, so if I pause, it's because I'm opening it again. At the age of 19, I had always known from a young age that God existed. I even talked to my mom about that, and she told me that I told her, I don't remember this, that I heard God speaking to me. And so from a young age, I just knew that there was more out there, right? I knew that God existed, and yet I never really came to him. But at the age of 19, I could no longer resist the tractor beam of God. There's something in my soul, in my mind, and I started searching. I was studying sports science, right, because I was 18 and I thought sports was cool, and why wouldn't you do that, right? But I thought, you know, there's got to be more to this, and I started feeling like, well, my purpose in life is going to be to speak to people. So I wanted to be a televangelist, mostly because of that arrogance I told you about. I wanted to be on TV, right? And I wanted to have a grandiosity complex, is what my therapist says. So I wanted to do Oprah-sized things, right? You get a car, and you get a car, and you get a humpback whale, right? So I wanted to do big stuff like that, not just small stuff. I felt like if I did small stuff, my life wouldn't be worth anything. I wouldn't be worth anything. And then at 19, I was offered God. God came to me in the form of AJ and Patty Hoff when I was waitering at the News Cafe in South Africa. And they invited me to church, and I blew them off. Just so you know that it wasn't me that came to God, it was God that came to me. Right? I blew my chance with them, but God kept on. And they met somebody called Claire. Claire and I used to drive to university together every day, college together every day. And I was kind of Claire's spiritual guru. I don't know how that happened because I was the most unspiritual, messed up. But I thought I was pretty spiritual, right? And she would come to me for advice. And then she told me that she's like, hey, I'm doing these Bible studies with this woman. And I'm like, well, I want to be a televangelist. And I just realized I've never read the Bible. I mean, I knew a lot about it, right? Because I'd heard it preached from the pulpit, a lot of like, you know, these flashy pastors in nice suits. Like, I know a lot about it, I just never read it. So I'll do these Bible studies. And that's how God got me. So I started studying with a guy named Justin Renton. And here's what struck me about the Christians that I met. Their loyalty, their worship was to the scriptures. My loyalty, my worship was of a God called me. Right? And it blew my mind that they weren't going to go by their own opinions. They weren't going to go by any of that stuff. They were going to go by whatever that book said, no matter how hard it was. They were for real. Second thing I saw about them was lifestyle and conviction. This isn't something they just did on Sundays. It's like, wow, they really believe this stuff during the week. They're building their schedules around the body, not around TV or some sports team that they follow or their jobs. They're building the big rock as God and the Bible, right? I was amazed, this is one of the biggest things, by how openly and unashamedly they shared their weaknesses, as if they were kind of like boasting in where they were weak. I had always been taught that that's the last thing on earth you want to do if you want people to like you. I was like, if people find out who I really am, I'm going to be alone, right? I'm not a nice person, right? But they boasted in those weaknesses, and that was incredible to me. I was inspired by the bigger purpose when they talked about, you know, imagine we could change the whole world or at least let the world know what we know in our generation. And I was like, dang, I know Jesus talked about that, but I've always kind of thought about it as a nice idea. These people think that it can be done, and they're actively doing it. So that inspired me, right? And they weren't trying to change or convince me. That was probably the nail in the coffin. Because I'd gone to plenty of churches, and one of my ministers actually said, every time I'd come in, he'd go, hey, celebrity appearance, good to see you, right? And I was like, yeah, you guys, in my head and in my heart, I was like, you guys need me more than I need you, right? I mean, I told you I'm arrogant. So that was my heart. But Justin looked at me one day, and he said, Tony, you really want this? I was like, yeah, I really want this. He's like, well, it seems like it's always us calling you. And I just don't want to do something that you don't want to do. And that the light bulbs went on for me. I was like, no, I want this, right? So that's what really helped me. And they accepted me and loved me in my arrogance, in my insecurity, right? In my lack of humility. They just loved me for who I was before I had done anything good. And they wanted me to be a part of what they were doing. That's powerful. And I often go back and I wonder, why me? Why me? I was not unique or special as I thought I was. There were 1,000 guys like me on campus. 1,000. Maybe more, right? They were maybe more talented or more good-hearted or doing more for the poor. I was doing nothing for anybody but myself. Why me? I look at myself today as a Christian and I'm like, still, why me? Right? Like, I'm a horrible father most of the time. I get it right once or twice. But man, you know, I'm not a great husband. Like, why does God choose me to get his message out to the world? I don't deserve it. It's nothing I've done. But it's because God, you can only come to him when he calls you. And because I realized that I'm a wreck and I'm a mess and that I can't do it without God and his people, maybe that's why. Maybe one day he realized, hey, you'll eventually figure out that I picked you not because you're great. I picked you for the opposite reason, right? Because you're not great. So God's moving me still from arrogance to humility, knowing that there's nothing about me that's distinct or special except him. God's moving me from insecurity to security. And I love this scripture in Ezekiel. On the day you were born, no one cared about you. Your umbilical cord was not yet cut, and you were never even washed or rubbed with salt or wrapped in cloth. No one had the slightest interest in you. No one pitied you or cared for you. On the day you were born, you were unwanted, dumped in a field, left to die. But I came by and saw you there, helpless, kicking about in your own blood as you lay there. And I said, live. He saw me as beautiful before I was. Amen. And I'm still not right, and I'm on my way there. But that's the beauty of it. And he's moving from independence to community, because Jeff probably spent 150 hours discipling me and my wife and kept us married. God did that, right? God's helping me be a better father, so I need people. So I hope my story helps you. We're going to sing a song about this. Somebody's calling my name. Can you stand with me? Okay, we got the right key. Here we go. If you don't know the words, just move, right? The Spirit will move you. Everything we're going to sing is in different languages. It's all the same thing. Jesus is calling your name. Somebody's calling my name.
Somebody's calling my name.
Somebody's calling my name.
Somebody's calling.
Come on.
Somebody's calling my name. Somebody's calling. Somebody's calling. Somebody's calling my.
Somebody's calling my name.
Somebody's calling my
name. African portion. To do do to do do do. He's calling you. To do do to do 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 to do 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 to do 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 to do 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 do. Jesus is calling my name.
Guys, the celebration is just getting started. We are having a potluck after this right over here. We have some people we asked to prepare a special display that you'll see out there representing many cultures. And then there's a lot of other food that many of you have brought and are bringing. And so we're going to go ahead and pray for the food. I think it's pretty self-explanatory. You just go out there, you'll see the plates, you'll see a drink station. And we have the FLC atrium available for some indoor seating. If you're like a younger person, you're like stronger, you might give those nice air-conditioned seats. Maybe some other kinds of people, you know what I'm saying? And but we can spread out as well amongst the grounds, find a shady spot, and we're just going to have fun enjoying many different cultures, celebrating what God has done. Let's go ahead and pray for the food. God, we're so grateful for what you've done among us, just hearing Tony's story and hearing just the fact that there are just countless stories that are just like that and unique in their own way throughout this entire room. God, the way that you have reached in, you've called us, you've brought us into your family, and we're so grateful. God, we pray that we can go out and be bold with your Holy Spirit, that we rely on you, that your love, your grace, your mercy would just go through us in the gospel message to this amazing world that we live in that desperately needs you, God. And we pray for the food. We're so grateful for the food that you provided, and help us to just enjoy each other's company as we break bread together. We love you. Pray in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to sing one more song. Because, when you have faith in what God can do, even if it's just faith the size of a mustard seed, a grain of mustard, you can say to that mountain, move, muévete, and se moverá, it will move. That's what Jesus said. Let's sing about it. Si tuviera. Como grano de mostaza. Come on. Eso lo dice el Señor. Si tuvieras fe como grano de mostaza. Eso lo dice el Señor. Tú le dirías a la montaña. Muévete, muévete. Tú le dirías a la montaña. Muévete, muévete. Esa montaña se moverá. Como grano de mostaza. ¡Vamos! Eso lo dice el Señor. Si tuvieras fe como grano de mostaza. Eso lo dice el Señor. Tú le dirías a la montaña. Muévete, muévete. Tú le dirías a la montaña. Muévete, muévete. Esa montaña se moverá. Como grano de mostaza. Eso, eso lo dice el Señor. Si tuvieras fe como grano de mostaza. Eso lo dice el Señor. Tú le dirías. Muévete, muévete. Let's continue to celebrate.